panel, which is about the metaverse, and it's very close to the place where are we now. If you are in a on an Avalon platform and you see our screen in the auditorium, it's the way how we invite you to taste and to feel and to experience by yourself. How does it feel being in that kind of space, and what's you actually missing there? Because now we're experiencing the metaverse spaces all around us a lot, and every time we miss something, yeah? So this is what I want, you know, to learn and to see, and also for our Web3 Stronger Together meetups and summits as well, because we want to improve this experience. We want to figure out what we could do for the next meetup even better, to feel ourselves like we are networking. So that's why we are here in that open discussion without any moderators, like it's happened on the networking live. Whenever you come, sit on the table, you don't know these people before, you haven't seen them, and you start to ask questions to each other, yeah? But before I will leave you the space for you guys, don't forget to have a quick intro about you and your project, and then to open the discussion. But before, I would love to show the one of the parts of our game and our gamification for the with the community that we had before the summit. It's a netizen Telegram gamified platform that we use in our chat. And I want to congratulate the winners that we have. And I would love to see how it works, because what we created through the with the netizen, we want to keep the lifelong experience interacting with the community, like this dashboard that we have here, and the winner that we have here, it's not the last, you know. We invite for people to continuing interaction with the Web3 Stronger Together and getting more and more and more rewards. In meanwhile, on the milestones, we will find the way to reward you. You know, we call that in Web3 Stronger Together, like we will give you money back to the community. This is how we want to build the Web3 Stronger Together, not to invest, you know, in the paid advertising, but we want to give it back to the market. So whenever you bring the value, we bring it back to the community. So I would love for those who have experienced the netizen platform in our chat, Web3 ST community, just to check it out. If you take part in that, it's all the time you can check your position in a game by just using the Dash leaderboard, and then it will upload. So the new like contest picture. So we have these 10 people, which I'm going to jump into the Twitter and just. While I hope while you we will end this panel discussion, I will send all the rewards to them. I will let you know. I will try to be as quick and as fast as you do here. And I hope you will enjoy here the moment of speaking with each other. And see you in 36 minutes. Drop the mic.
Thank you so much, Olesya. It was great to hear from you again. And first of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Steph Norbert. I am the CTO at Neotech Finance. We are based in Romania. And what we do is we create the real world metaverse. And what does this mean? For the past decade, we've been scanning and recreating digital twins of entire cities, be that we talk outside or inside. And now we try to bring what we do best in the real world, which is scan and recreate digital twins and bring them into metaverse experiences. Here we can talk about museums. Here we can talk about sports events. We can talk about the gambling industry, recreating entire casinos, even in AR and in VR as well, recreating music experiences by scanning entire stadiums and creating a concert. Or in the education area, where we also have a project implemented in one of our universities, and we are still working on it. It's a virtual tour in a metaverse with a bot which has ChatGPT integrated, and you can ask him any questions which I believe has a very great impact. I'm really curious to see what is your perception of the metaverse as well. What do you guys think? And to have an open discussion of how us with Neotech and with you, our deal panelists, could we create this boom in the metaverse industry?
Well, I can jump in. Well, hi all. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yeah.
Perfect. So my name is Luis Bravo Martins. My day job is being the CMO at KTR. KTR is an industrial augmented reality startup. I started working in immersive tech in 2014-2015. Since then, I have been developing more and more this feeling that, again, virtual reality, augmented reality would be foundationally affecting our behavior, our way of life, our civilization, if I dare say, something like that. But more and more, I also started to realize that there were several other technologies appearing. Again, blockchain, you have also several flavors of AI also in the mix. Then suddenly we see that several of these are continuously converging. So, and this has been like happening for quite some time. Like we saw like in the past decade that suddenly our smartphone was not just something to write messages and to put in text, but it actually aggregated the ability to stream, to do lives, to interact with augmented reality filters or through augmented reality filters. So in a nutshell, we have been through this accelerated technological convergence for quite some time. As I see it, the metaverse, it's going to be like a milestone in this journey that we are having right now. It's going to be the third iteration, the third stage of the web, which means that we are not yet there, but right now we have several technologies with which we are working on that will be foundational. And we know that they will be foundational in order to create a 3D, real-time, spatialized version of the internet that will allow us to have our very own identity, our a hybrid economy, and to enable all of that, we have to have a lot of services, a lot of technology, a lot of solutions in place, and we still have a long way to go. But getting back to what was said, I think, in the second panel, so how can we like make this make adoption grow? I guess it starts by us focusing on everything else than, or anything else rather than the technology itself. Because no one says when, for instance, using the smartphone, oh, now I'm going to open a GSM protocol and I'm going to perform a connection with yet another device. No, I just say that I'm going to call someone, right? Because that's the purpose, that's the service that I'm going to enjoy from this. So it all has to do at the end with the use cases. It all has to do with the benefits that I'm going to extract from, again, all these foundational technologies, all the these convergence possibilities that exist. So clearly, I am enthusiastic about all the possibilities that are right now here and the ones that are going to be opened next week with the presentation from Apple. Most probably it's going to be like also a big deal, yet another headset, smart glasses. But more than that, I'm really enthusiastic about everything that is happening around us. That and pretty much about everything that is being developed by entrepreneurs like like yourselves, because again, at the end of the day, that's what people will look for. It's again not the technology, it's not the infrastructure that needs to be in place, and that also is business. But the adoption will come when the value is there. I don't know what you think.
Do we still do introductions, or we?
I would like to give a little feedback for this.
Yeah,
because I would like to give you a little feedback, Luis. It was really interesting what you said. And I heard something that everything on the internet will become more spatial. And the technology, will it be VR or AR? And I would like to hear also your opinion. What do you think? Are we going to be more VR or AR oriented in the future?
Yeah, guys, but before we start the conversation, don't you think it would be fair if all of us introduce each other? Because you two introduced each other and jumped into the topic right away. So.
I'm sorry. It was really interesting and I had to, but I will get back to it, please.
Yeah. Should I go?
Please, yeah. Maria, leave.
Yeah. My name is Maria. I'm the CEO of Interstellar Digital PR agency. We are focused on tech industry and we work with a lot of games and gaming studio like XLab, Kiraverse powered by Mutable, and Caesarverse. And Caesarverse CEO Colin is now online as well. So yeah, that's it about me.
And perfect. About the metaverse, what's your take?
Do you answer your question already... right away? Or
no, about this concept, I think it was launched by Steph, this notion about what do we think is the metaverse, any kind of entered, I think, the general topic of our discussion.
Well, I like gaming metaverses, and we worked with a lot of gaming metaverses. And I think that's the future, but I feel like the metaverse should have also some other aspect, for example, educational aspect or immersive aspect or any other aspect that actually will bring like a massive Web3 adoption. And because if you like, if there is some other purpose for you to go to the metaverse other than entertainment and fun, maybe like it will bring a lot of people, and a lot more people will try to, you know, do their homework in the metaverse or study in the metaverse or try new outfits in the metaverse. So in my opinion, metaverse should have some useful purpose. Of course, entertainment is important, but there should be something more to that. That's my opinion. Who's next? Colin or Edwin?
Okay. I'm Colin Helm, founder and CEO of Building Block Studios in the Caesarverse. Essentially, what we do is we create historically accurate open world video games for various time periods, our first one being Rome, hence the Caesarverse. And circling back to the metaverse conversation, I think the strength of the metaverse lies in its ability to create digital societies and communities. And through that, it not only fosters interaction and, you know, the technology, I think we can all agree, is pretty spectacular at this point. It's only going to get better from here, but it allows for meaningful interaction. And I think that's something that we're yet to truly see on a widespread scale. You know, one way to do that is through gaming. Which we're doing. Another way I think is interesting, like Maria brought up, is through education, you know, virtual museums, virtual environments where people can actually interact with, you know, various times in history, or say it's a marine biology class, like you can interact with various maritime species instead of just looking at a book and reading about them. Additionally, I think, you know, we need a large user base to make a metaverse truly reach its full potential. If you're looking at some of them, you know, 20 people, 30 people online at a given time isn't going to create meaningful community, versus if you're able to have thousands of concurrent users, like you'd see in like a Web2 game, at that point, you can really foster relationships with other people in game, and it allows for cooperative and, you know, team building exercises in that sense.
Very solid. I like it. My name is Edwin Mata. I'm the CEO and founder of Ricken. I'm specialized in tokenization. Did some exercises in different kinds of metaverse just to try how to augment the reality. So in the sense for me, metaverse is we're not there yet. We are in some preliminary work for that, like full immersion that people think on the metaverse is like, I'm already in my full digitized version in this metaverse. But in the end, augmented reality is also metaverse, right? So we have some great examples about there, kind of like, can we amplify our own reality with some tech for further enhancement, being in education, being when you're buying clothes, being when you're buying a flat. So for me, it's kind of like that's the metaverse that I wanted to thrive before we go into the full immersive, kind of like we see in the movies, right? Not trying to be criticized. I'm just saying that I don't believe we're there yet. It's going to take us some time. That's why I was leaning on trying and testing some things in 2021 when everybody was talking. So we were digitizing assets, so trying to build a digital twin from a real world asset and then fractionalize it in some kind of land. But I mean, we always knew that was kind of like experiments just to test, because in the end, the real user wants the real utility. And it's kind of like, how is my life going to get better? And I think we are going to get there where we understand the full capacity of being fully digital and transforming ourselves into a digital being. But as of now, we're still very real. So I rather see that augmented reality that through my phone, I can enhance my aspects of my daily life, or I can already see where my painting in my house is going to look like before I even nail it on the wall. So it's kind of like that's useful. And that's kind of like the metaverse that I want first to thrive before we fully immerse. So that's just my opinion.
I really like what you said there, and it's something I wanted to ask before from Luis as well, because he mentioned AR and VR. And here I would like to say, to give an example, and I would really like your feedback to let me know what you think is best, since we're working on multiple projects. One of them is an AR app, which can be used either on your 4 or on Unreal glasses, AR glasses, where we create an entire virtual tour of a real life city, for example, Paris, and you will be able to put on your glasses and see touristic information about it. And we are working also on a VR experience in a university where you will be completely, to say it like that, you can be on your couch and somebody to give you a tour in the university. And how do you see this VR or AR in the metaverse? I'm really curious because I believe it would help our company as well to get a feedback from you to know how to work forward.
Well, first of all, just to share that I am very much aligned with what you said, Edwin, and also getting or circling back to what I shared before. The fact that it's spatialized and the fact that it's 3D doesn't mean that we are then all going to change our screens for augmented reality glasses and augmented reality headsets in 10 to 15 years. So that what I believe is that we will have yet another way to access assets and to access digital venues, digital spaces, or digital representations of people, and that we will be able to have specialized 3D, more meaningful, again, interactions with these assets. So I think there will be, it's going to be yet another option. For me, my main usage, for instance, for VR headsets and for VR experiences is going to events. So I just before starting this meetup or this panel, we were just talking about, and I was hearing you talking about this possibility of us participating in events, and one of you, I think, I think it was you, Steph, that you've met before, Alicia, I think.
Yeah, we met in Lisbon, and yes, exactly.
Exactly. So for instance, I've been on the opposite, in the opposite position. So I worked with someone for, I don't know, maybe 6 years in VR, online, through before COVID, during COVID. Never had I been with that person until last October. We closed several projects. We worked on them. We delivered them. I was up to date with her life. She was like going from one job to another. But I wasn't, for instance, I didn't even know how tall she was. And she's small. She's short. but this to say, it's again, the fact that we not only are able to trust, not only are we able to build relationships at a distance, and leveraging these technologies, not just the fact that this is already happening, and I wanted to like highlight that that, but more than that, the fact that these kind of relationships, I think, as you said, they're different. They're not the same thing. They're yet another layer, yet another part of our lives. Now, the issue is that this is actually cool, because I also would like to have your thoughts on this. The fact is that as we change our perception of reality through virtual reality, through augmented reality, we also change our memory of reality. So, for instance, if I put in the glasses and I am in a classroom during those 15 minutes and I'm seeing like the Battle of Waterloo, seeing how it went, and I have like the teacher telling me how to go through and what happened, and then I am out of that and I come back to the classroom. During those 15 minutes, those students, their memories will be of that battle. Not just because they were in there, but because they shared the experience. Now, this leads me to the question that I'm going to drop here. So, was that virtual reality experience real for those guys during those 15 minutes?
I think that Colin should answer that, because that's exactly what Caesarverse does. They bring, like, in the future, they will bring students to ancient Rome to study, to basically complete the mission and, like, study something about battles or wars. Colin, I think you should tell more about it.
Yeah, definitely. I have a lot of thoughts on this because that's what we do. But yeah, I think it's one of those things where, especially if you're looking at modern students, they have so many more distractions and a shorter attention span than students 20 years ago, like when I was in school. So yeah, I think to some degree it is a real experience. In other ways, you know, obviously it's an artificial experience. You weren't truly there, you know, in the 1800s, but I think it allows for a much deeper understanding, not just of the time period and the cultural norms and, you know, the strategic thinking of lining up in rows and shooting at each other like at Waterloo, which makes no sense in the current day, but also of, you know, tactics, political atmosphere, and things of that nature. I think that one of the greatest strengths of AR and VR is immersion. And obviously AR doesn't provide quite the same level as immersion with, like, you know, and graphical overlay, think Google Glass, you know, you're interacting with the physical world at the same time, but in a way it can be stronger. And just like if you're trying to learn a language, just, you know, step going back to Paris, the easiest way to learn a language is to immerse yourself in the environment. And it's the same with history or science or anything else. We learn more on the classroom field trips to an aquarium than we did reading a textbook. We learn, if you want to learn French, go to Paris. Do not buy a textbook. That's not the most efficient way to do it. So yeah, I think it might not be real in a true sense, but it's meaningful. And those meaningful experiences that you can create through using the technology will leave a much greater impact on the student.
Sorry.
I was gonna make a joke. I mean, for studying Roman history in a Roman environment, right? That's like enhancing. Like if you're a kid and they teach you history by traveling to the spot, Like, who wouldn't want to go to school? Like, I will never skip school again. I will be in school every single day. So I think it's also kind of like that grade of gamification. Because right now everybody's gaming, right? We got this play to earns that they say, like, oh, we're going to go for it. And then everything is going to be in the metaverse and everything. But I mean, what gaming has taught us, it's that it's fun, right? But there's a lot of things in gaming. When you're shooting, there's a study about how your eyes and your interaction with the fingers and everything just becomes better. I mean, nobody knows that. But actually, there's some very good things about shooters. And I'm just making a stupid example. But the thing is, when we bridge that gaming into education or that kind of like augmented reality, I mean, people are tend to be more likable. What is the app for studying languages, right? Everybody wants to, I have a friend who's always flexing. Yeah, I just went level, I don't know. I'm like, I don't play it, but I understand the word level that his mentality is like, oh, I'm reaching the next level. Oh, I'm going to give this. And he's learning a language. So it's kind of like, that's crazy. You're just playing against the app who's teaching you and all that. I mean, that can be super enhanced with like everything that we call it in Metaverse. So I love the educational part when it's blended with technology, and then when just a layer of gamification. I think that's the real future of many things. Kind of like we're just grabbing a lot of things happening every day and then just trying to see how we can exponentially make something out of it, a product that can help us. Well, that's my perspective, of course.
What I wanted to say and add is that with your question, I believe you described it perfectly from my point of view, what the metaverse is. It's a much better online experience with which you can learn, you can study, you can game, you can gamify, you can play, you can gamble, you can go to the casinos. And it's not just an entertainment center, I believe. I believe there's many aspects and use cases where this can be implied and be used in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. And I also see that if you look now, being a user of the internet today is already different from what it was like 10 years ago. Like 10 years ago, you would be like a user. Maybe you would be like a creator. Maybe you were like hustling to try and influence people. But now you can invest. Now you can own. So now there are so many roles that I can through which I can participate in the web dynamics. In this case, we're talking about Web3, but it could be like several other kinds of communities and services. At the end, the topic has to do a lot more, I think, with expanding our ability to interact digitally. And I do believe that today we are seeing more and more those possibilities now, like since the last quarter of last year with AI services, namely generative AI. Other solutions keep on appearing, other flavors of AI like conversational. Apple glasses. So all of those, I think, will contribute directly to us, like having more and more time in online, digital time, sorry, time with digital assets. But at the same time, I think that for us, and now circling back to the topic up here, so I do believe that for us to have these virtual or this metaverse to actually come into effect, we will need, well, first of all, to start thinking about everything that allows for instance, for the experience, our experience to be as seamless as possible when, for instance, transitioning between one world and the other. Like how to safeguard that we can like maintain our avatar, our identity, our property throughout all of these virtual worlds, and at the same time also be able to interact with the users in each and every world pretty much in the same way, so that there is no so that the ramp up of a new platform is not that big. So there are like, I would now just drop, I'd like to give a shout out to the people from the Metaverse Standards Forum. It's like a congregation of several different associations, NGOs, standard organizations that are actively working towards creating standards that will effectively enable the metaverse to come into effect. So I do believe that it's through the effort of these guys that, and most of them are volunteers, that this vision of an interconnected metaverse will happen. And I suggest everyone listening also to drop them a visit and see if you can also contribute.
I think that events like in the metaverse and in real life is actually like another way of like using the metaverse and bringing more people, because I remember back in 2021 at Miami NFT Week had an event offline, like in real life, and they also had event in the metaverse, and they were able to sell like 3,000 tickets to the metaverse, because a lot of people, they didn't want to fly to Miami or didn't have an opportunity, so they went to the event in the metaverse with a discounted price. But it was like exactly how real event was, like exactly same stages, same speakers. They just was it, like the whole event was just streamed in the metaverse, and there was the same expo area in the metaverse. And for example, me and Colin, we are attending 3XP conference in Los Angeles during the LA Tech Week, and Caesarverse is hosting ancient Rome inspired toga party. And like, if we could do it in the metaverse as well, and like the whole Web3 gaming conference could be in the metaverse and our toga party could be in the metaverse, that would be like so great, because not everybody want to fly across the country to Los Angeles. Not everybody has an opportunity to come to United States at all. So I think like events in the metaverses, or maybe events in real life that are duplicated in the metaverse, that's I think another aspect of metaverse accelerating Web3 adoption. I would say that. What are your thoughts, guys?
Maybe I feel like sports could be, oh sorry, I didn't mean to cut
yeah,
you
yeah, go ahead.
I feel like sports could be a really great metaverse experience as well. You know, think about attending a Champions League final and sitting, you know, right at the center of the pitch or something like that. You know, Olympics, you're experiencing them. You feel like you're right in the center of it. And obviously that broadcasting's, the quality of broadcast has gone up drastically in the last 10, 15 years with better resolution cameras, more cameras on the field. But that's just another idea that came into my mind that could really immerse you in the atmosphere. You know, it's very different watching a match on TV versus being in the stands with the singing and the chanting and that whole atmosphere. And if we can use technology to recreate that excitement and that thrill, that could be a really good way to onboard more people from the Web2 audience into the Web3 community and show them the value that a metaverse holds.
Yeah, I'm taking that sports thing. Just imagine, or even if you go to the match itself, you can watch it from home, or you can go to the match and they get augmented, because maybe to the phone you can get like the real data information, speed. So you can have a lot of information that you don't have, because when you're on TV, you get blasted with data as to how the match is happening. But when you're on the spot, you just like focus on that. So maybe you can even amplify your experience, right? Because in the end, it's all about how can we just get better at something. So if I'm watching, I don't know, a boxing match, I would like to see, hey, did you do that here and all of that? I don't know. I mean, it's just that right now, imagination, it can just go. Or you go to a Monaco F1 race, why not? And you see the speed. I mean, you just see a car pass by, but you're like, okay, just 1 second. But maybe you would like to see, hey, this guy's third and the speed is this. So it's kind of like everything is just about making it better. But obviously that's for the real life, but from home, and then having the experience of somebody that is on the spot. I mean, that just levels out the field. Maybe it's not the same because everything in reality tends to be better, but at least it's an opportunity given to everybody. So I'm in for that specific. I would love that.
Yeah, here I can tell you in the sports industry, the NBA, the National Basketball Association from the US, is already working on an AR application to give a better experience to their fans, where they can see these advanced stats that you very well pointed out, and which can lead to a mass adoption of AR or VR, the sport having a lot of fans. And through sports, there are some connections that get you more attached to something than any other thing. And I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I'm saying I agree. Sorry, you went through. I was like, yeah, that sounds amazing. I mean,
yeah, we all love sports. Everybody loves sports. And besides sports, what I believe is a very good use case is the gambling industry. I've attended the online casino summit in Rome a couple of weeks ago. And there are some applications that are created in VR and in AR where I was stunned. We went to the Vatican and somebody just pulled out his phone and put on an Unreal glass, looked at the building, at the church, and a big roulette appeared in front of it. And I believe that you will be able to give an experience to attract old customers and new customers as well, which will lead to our topic to mass adoption and to be used by more people.
Yeah, absolutely. By the way, Colin is going to Rome to make Caesarverse game even more historically accurate. And I imagine when the game will be like fully ready, then like if people go to like Caesarverse Metaverse, they can see ancient Rome, how it was, because now even like Colosseum or some other buildings, they are in ruins right now. But in the game, you could see like how was it thousands of years ago, which is cool. Like I would be interested. I'm a huge history nerd.
Here we maybe could even work together because we have in our roadmap to create a digital twin of entire Rome as well, and to create an AR tour or a VR tour of Rome with specific historical informations. And this is what I like best in these networking events. Even on a panel, you could almost create a partnership and to start to work on a project together. What do you think? Wouldn't it be awesome?
Yeah, definitely. I like it. Let's do it.
Wonderful. Meanwhile, I think we all agree that it's all about the use cases. It's all about the markets and the value that people are going to benefit from. So I would just like to like drop two things about that. So the first one is a shameless plug. So I was last February, I co-authored this book from Wiley with Samantha on the metaverse, and it's like a straightforward guide, much more business oriented rather than a technology oriented book that explores again the opportunities and challenges involved in the rise of the metaverse. Our chapter 8 has 64 pages, and it just focuses on the examples that already exist, and also possibilities or opportunities arising in 22 markets for the metaverse, where all of those that you referred actually appear, besides gaming, production, also automotive, aerospace, the military, the healthcare, art, architecture, hospitality, manufacturing, training, so a lot. So I think at the end, it has to do, and now you see so many great opportunities because of that. You just have to like jump in and check what is being done. how it's being done, and most probably you will be able to like create your own flavor with the added value, with your own added value of that business, which in itself is a great opportunity. So that's the first one. Second one I wanted to share also is that it's not all opportunities, and it's not everything is not just pink. We do have a lot of challenges. There are a lot of safety issues in the metaverse in using metaverse technologies. So talking about virtual reality is not the metaverse. So talking about like virtual reality or augmented reality or even blockchain worlds and Web3 communities, all of them have specific safety, specific privacy issues. We are all dealing with the policy construction as we go ahead. So it's really, really important also to be mindful of consumers, be mindful of users, be mindful of community fellows, and at the same time, be mindful that there are bad agents and that those bad agents will are possibly like some of the worst destroyers of potential adoption that we may be building, and they can do it really, really quickly. So enabling tools, and by tools I'm talking about market rule codes, about communities coming together and setting up rule sets, to clear regulation being in place, I think that we all should also focus on that. And in itself, maintaining privacy and maintaining safety in itself, I think it's also going to be a great market.
I agree. So as a by note, I think it's, I love this conversation. I don't think we all went from like more of a useful case, kind of like the augmented part without pushing too much like the boundaries. I think, I'm glad 2021 happened, 2022, because everybody was chilling kind of like the metaverse without use, and everybody's saying like, yeah, everything is real. I don't know how many metaverses out there got funded. So it was kind of like crazy and ridiculous because it's like, okay, you got all this million, but you're forgetting one thing, your user. And the user has to get there, not just to get an avatar. It has to be some kind of use, because your challenge is to, if it's a gamer, to be a better experience than what they can require from a gaming experience. So I was very skeptical and very critical to all the things that were happening in the metaverse, but I did saw a lot of innovation from a standup of the augmented part. And in this chat, all I heard was like, everybody's really looking forward and building something that is useful. And us sometimes in the blockchain, we forget that, first of all, it's not just money making and raising. It's kind of like we have to create a product that is used by people whose pains we're trying to solve, because this is how companies should be built. So I think obviously this is not my first metaverse geek on an event, but I do feel like the maturity of people staying and building has grown from some of the other speaking spots where it was like, no, that's not the metaverse. It's not the Decentraland. It is one, but there's so many things. So I think maybe for the next bull run, we'll see some great products being built and a lot of people using them, and then just really pushing like the metaverse world is not a virtual world. It's not you going full digital. The metaverse starts from your house, from your phone, from your computer, from you walking to the streets, from you getting all the data. So yeah, just my positive end.
Oh, I agree entirely. You know, just because you can build something doesn't necessarily mean you should if there's no actual value or use case. And I think in 2022, we saw a lot of those, you know, filtered out. And I think now there's more of a focus on like, how does this solve customer issues? How does this provide value to users, even on a macro sense? Maybe I'm getting a little holistic here, but how does this advance, you know, humanity as a species technologically? Like, what does this do for us collectively? And a lot of what we were seeing that was there yesterday, not today, might not have had value as the primary focus. It was more, you know, just because we can, and they never answered the question of why. So I agree with you, Edwin, on that.
Yeah, just to give a feedback regarding this as well, I believe that in the next bull run, only the projects that truly have something will remain. And this can mean only mass adoption and great news for the entire Web3 industry. And I'm really glad for this discussion. I'm glad I could have met you. It's great to see you again, Olesya. It was truly a pleasure to be here, and thank you.
Yeah, I agree. And I actually think that bear market is the perfect time to build. It's like a lot of people say it, and it became like a, I don't know, cage phrase, but I truly do. And I don't think that projects and metaverses that doesn't have real value, they will survive, even if they are funded by VCs or angels. The lack of users will kill them in the future. So yeah, that's what I said at the beginning, that we need to build something with like a real value and use case. And thank you so much for insightful conversation. And Luis, I will check your book out. Thank you for it.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. We were focusing on this panel on the building the metaverse. But the question I ask myself is how many hours I spend in metaverse daily, weekly, monthly, and how does that experience influence on me? And from that perspective, to see which metaverse I want to build. So I would probably, this is a topic for the next panel and for the next summit, because I found myself sometimes very dig deep into the virtual world, and I would love to have sometimes, you know, to bring myself back. So, and that is how the metaverse actually is building in from inside, you know, does it leave us a space to live the life out of that? So there is a lot of things like out there, and I would love to explore with you guys more. If you never, you will have any thoughts on that, please share and write or send the messages. It will be great to continue this conversation. And it was, I agree, Maria, with you. And I really love how you handle this space for everyone. Thank you so much for being a moderator for the meeting. This is what we call, you know, the Web3 stronger together, because whenever we build and create together, and sometimes we need to define a place for them. This is cool. So I haven't done the transferring for the winners yet, because I have mistaken in 1 hour. Actually, it's starting now in 10 minutes. But this is also part of the virtual game. You know, sometimes you're like, you're messing the time zones. So we have 2 minutes more. If anyone has a few words to say, like, how to keep ourselves in this metaverse world, it would be great. If not, we'll just go close the session.
I'd just like to double up on the call for contributors, for people. Everyone can participate in building their own vision of the metaverse. It really is important, I think, for all of us, be them people building businesses, being them people working in social society, be them like people doing so many different things. We need, if we're talking about something that is human-centered, we need all the social sciences, human sciences also to be a part of this. So calling out all anthropologists, sociologists, philosophers, and at the same time, all lawyers, all retailers to come in and to test it and to put their hands down on or put their hands dirty and have their hands dirty on the technology, or else they will just be like thinking inside someone else's brain, and that will lead nowhere. So please test, experiment, and then test again, and try and find the value that is here for you to reap.
That's a good point to finish, yeah, guys. How do you think? Show me.
Yes.
Yeah, show me. Hands up. Yeah. So, see you in the space then, co-builders, co-operators, co-creators. Yeah. See you. And the next panel will start in 10 minutes.